So I'm going to present a paper with a slightly pretentious title called The Demography of Human Development and Climate Change Vulnerability, a Projection Exercise. I don't know if you're familiar with popular British music of the 70s, 80s, and 90s, but ranging back from David Bowie to The Smiths and The Wedding Present, they used to have extremely pretentious titles for actually very beautiful small pop nuggets. It's pretty much what I'm going to be doing here. So this is going to be a little pop jangly guitar jewel where I'm just putting together much of the projection work that we have been doing at the Wittgenstein Center into projections of the Human Development Index. So that's basically the idea of this. I think, let me use this. I think that this is the type of crowd that I don't have to convince that development determines vulnerability to natural hazards. We've been talking about it for 3 days. So the basic idea and the motivation of this paper was that when you're trying to have a look at the effects of climate change on vulnerability, or how ready are countries going to be in order to face the challenges of climate change in terms of natural disasters, people in the literature tend to compare values of income per capita, education, Human Development Index of today to eventual futures. And what we're trying to do here is just to bring together all the projections that have been going on at the Wittgenstein Center in order to create Human Development Index projections for each one of those SSPs that you just heard about, in order to be able to compare vulnerability in the framework of existing projection methods, and in order eventually to put it into integrated assessment models. The choice of the Human Development Index, as criticized as it is in many cases, is just based on the fact that most of the literature uses it and tends to find that there is a nice correlation between vulnerability to disasters and the development in general, and in this case, the Human Development Index. You have here a couple of papers that do that. Erich himself has been doing it, Wolfgang, and Tony Patt in the PNAS did it in 2010 also. You're gonna see a couple of graphs of that paper in a minute. As I told you, the humble aim of this paper is just to develop a framework in order to obtain projections of the Human Development Index. So as you may know, you're gonna see it in a second, the Human Development Index has three components. One of them is based on health and mostly on life expectancy. Developments, the other one is based on education, you just saw pretty much what we are going to do there. And the other one is based on income per capita, of which I will tell you a little bit more about how we did those projections, because those are the ones that have not been at least obviously presented until now. Okay, I will also present HDI projections up to the year 2075 for the five SSPs that we heard about. Okay, if you have a look at the literature, the measurement of development, which is such an abstract concept, has been materialized in the use of many different variables, from income per capita to population density, fertility, access to drinking water, governance indicators. What has become more of a fashion in the literature is to use the Human Development Index, pretty much due to this type of results that you can see in here. So what you have on the y-axis, in this case, is the part of the people affected by disasters that cannot be explained through population and other socio-demographic variables. And here you have the Human Development Index. And as you can see, there's overall a negative relationship, and that there is a certain non-linearity, implying that it's up to certain levels of development where you start to see improvements in a decrease of vulnerability to disasters. It's not as clear if you go to the deaths instead of to the affected, but there's still a significant relationship and significant negative relationship going on, at least for high levels of the Human Development Index. Okay, so it has been actually found to be a good way to put together into one number a kind of an overall measure of development. Now, as I told you, I'm going to be interested in the Human Development Index and in forecasting it or in projecting it. As you can see, the Human Development Index is just a geometric mean of three indices. You have the index that corresponds to income, the index that corresponds to life expectancy, and the index that corresponds to education. I'm not going to talk very much about these two, because pretty much what Edish presented is how we are doing it. We have population projections by sex, age, and education. We know life expectancy differentials across age groups and education groups. So eventually, it's going to be really easy to get those two numbers, at least within the framework. And then what's going to be more challenging is how to still, within the context of human capital-driven development, how to link that to movements in economic growth. That's pretty much my job as the economist in the gang. Okay. Let me go just briefly into how each one of these sub-indices are composed, are created. It's extremely simple. The health component of the Human Development Index is just an index where you normalize the life expectancy based on the minimal life expectancy observed over the existing data. And you normalize it by the range of life expectancy so that the number is between 0 and 1. So given a maximum level and a minimum level of life expectancy, it's just a linear function of life expectancy. As you saw through Eric's presentation, I'm so happy that he presented all that stuff before, because it makes my job much easier. You can actually, given differentials of life expectancy across all the groups and all the colors that you saw before, you can just get the number for each one of the SSPs. Needless to say, as you move to the future, you need to update the fact that, the Human Development Index is just a relative number. The best country is going to be always one. So you will need to be updating each one of these sub-indices in such a way that the maximum observed life expectancy becomes the new one. So basically, this guy here, in reality, in our projections, is going to have also a little T, and it's going to be updated all the time. For the case of the education component, it's slightly more complex, but still very easy to follow. It has two components in itself, so it's a geometric mean of two components. One of them is the mean years of schooling of the country, and the other one is something called expected years of schooling, which is, as you can imagine, just a function of school enrollment. So the idea is, what would be the years of schooling that a child born at that moment is expected to have during its life. So it's basically given by the enrollment rates at that moment or by the projected enrollment rates. As you saw before, we have all those things. I mean, we have them in terms of shares of people with primary, secondary, and tertiary education, so we just need to transform that into mean years of schooling, which is not a big problem. And then we can also project the expected years of schooling in the sense of being the projected values in 25 years, okay, so that they are also consistent within each one of the SSPs. As I told you here, Wolfgang and Samir have already done that one way or another. Edish has also been using them and presented them before. And the index for income, which probably will require a little bit more of explaining, in terms of the sub-index of income, is exactly the same as the one of life expectancy. So we're going to have exactly the same type of idea. You have income per capita. It's measured in gross national income per capita in 2005 international dollars, at least in the 2010 Human Development Index. You standardize so that it's between 0 and 1 by dividing by the range of income per capita as observed. What we are going to do, of course, these numbers are fixed in the Human Development Index right now. What we will do as we project it is update the maximum one. Okay? And now the idea is going to be, well, how can we link all the changes in population by age, sex, and education to the development of income per capita in a country? Okay, the fully fledged model with 1,000 robustness checks and everything is in a paper of mine. However, I'm going to tell you basically how we did it, or a little bit of the background of how we did it. Now comes the economist talk, so I'm sorry about it. Usually I don't have to apologize for being an economist, but in some audiences I have to. It's a problem of interdisciplinarity, right? So the idea is extremely simple. If you again back to the 70s and to David Bowie, if you were to ask somebody in the 1970s about how to put education into an economic growth model, they would tell you that, well, that's relatively easy. People with different levels of education have different levels of labor productivity, so they are like different types of input of the production process. So just put them, instead of having one labor input, which is just the average person, just have several labor inputs that correspond to each one of those persons with some level of education. So basically, we're going to start there. This is still 1970s. We're going to start there, and we're going to assume that total output is a function of the capital stock, of course, and of that disaggregated labor input. So that's labor by level of education and by age. So we're going to have, in this case, just two broad age groups, basically 15 to 35 and over 35. Again, million of robustness checks. It doesn't really matter if you take 40. So we're going to have an old group and a young or an older group or a younger group. And we're going to have labor without education, with primary education, with secondary education, with tertiary education. Okay. Now, if you take this production and you have, of course, total factor productivity, which is going to be basically the technological progress making all the inputs of production become more productive over time. This usually in theoretical models is assumed to, or in old exogenous growth theoretical models, it's assumed to grow at an exogenous rate, so basically everybody is getting more productive over time. If we take that production function and just log it and take the first difference, then we have basically a specification for economic growth. Here you have the growth rate of output being a function of the growth rate of technology, the growth rate of capital, which is related to investment, and the growth rates of each one of those disaggregated labor inputs. Okay, the problem with this model as such is that education, or what appeared clear in the literature then in the 90s, is that education in this model only creates level effects in income per capita. It does not accelerate growth rates of income per capita in the long run, which is something that we may imagine that education can also do. Since here education only affects your productivity and not the total factor productivity, then you're going to end up with a model where changes in education are just creating level effects in your income per capita, but not changing the long-run growth rate. We skip to the 90s, and in the 90s, the so-called Nelson-Phelps paradigm entered economic growth theory by precisely including this idea that education does much more than just making you more productive. It also affects your ability to create or to adopt technology and make the whole economy or all inputs of production, including those that are not just your education group, more productive. The idea is extremely simple, or when it comes to specifying a model like that, we took a very simple specification and we said that the growth rate of technology is going to depend, notice, not in the increases in human capital, that is, as the other part, which are the changes in those groups, but on the actual human capital stock that you have, that is on the shares of people with several education levels. So the more human capital you have, the higher the likelihood that you will create new inventions that improve your technology. You tend to see that people that create inventions actually on average tend to have more education than those that don't create it. So the basic idea is that education also makes you a more creative person and therefore helps you improve the technology of a country. That is one of the effects that go through human capital on technology growth. The other one is related to the fact that relatively poorer countries, in the sense of countries which are farther away from the technology frontier, are going to be able to grow quicker just by catching up on all technologies which are already available but that have not been adopted by that country yet. Now, education plays also an extremely important role, historically and empirically, in how quickly that adoption process takes place. If you think of East Asia in the 80s, part of the idea of the extremely high growth rates of income per capita here was based on the fact that you had a very skilled labor that was able to adopt technologies through imitation and actually be able to re-export them and so on. So the other part, or the other way in which education is affected the growth rate of technology, is going to be through the interaction of how educated you are and how rich you are, how far away from the technological frontier you are. So the idea is, if you're very far away from the technological frontier, but you have a relatively high level of education, you will be able to catch up quicker than if it's not the case. Okay, and then you have a part which is autonomous in terms of there is a catching up to the technological frontier independent of your level of education. So you have the level of education affecting how quickly you are moving to the technological frontier and thinking about more advanced economies by how much the technology frontier itself is moving through new technologies. If you put the two things together, you take this guy and you plug this big guy, then you get to a specification that is telling you, hey, if you want to explain the growth rates of GDP, just regress them on the one hand, the growth rates of each one of those education age groups on their shares, on their stocks, on the human capital stocks, on the interaction of the human capital stock and how far away you are from the frontier, that is how poor you are, how rich you are, and the same thing in here, right? And of course, the growth rate of the capital stock, which, as you will see, we will then basically project in a relatively standard way. Okay, so we took this model. We took data for 120 countries over the period 1970 to 2010 at 5-year intervals. Needless to say, we could only do this thanks to the reconstruction efforts that took place at the Wittgenstein Center in order to create those education age groups. And we basically run a regression. We have done several papers dealing with this type of thing. So you have, as you can imagine, you have a big problem of multicollinearity in there because you have many age groups, you have many education levels. We have come across this problem differently in each one of the papers that we have done because we wanted to try different things. So in some cases, we have used shrinkage estimators. In some other cases, we have used principal components. Here, this is the simplest possible case. We have used general to specific model selection. So basically, we start with a big model full of inflated parameter estimates, and then we start to get rid of one at a time until we arrive at a model that we are happy with. Again, the other type of model selection methods lead to models which are comparable or whose results are comparable. If we concentrate on the very last model, which is the one that we are actually going to use, it only contains significant variables with the exception of the capital stock, which is not really significant, but it has the type of value that you would expect from theory. If you concentrate on that model, you can see, first of all, the parameter estimate associated to the initial level of income per capita is negative. That implies that there is conditional convergence. The poorer you are, given the other variables, the poorer you are, the farther away you are from your equilibrium, the quicker that you converge to it. However, and now we go here to the interaction between the share of working age population with tertiary schooling and initial income per capita. As you can see, it's also negative and relatively high, actually, compared to this guy. That implies that if you compare two countries who are the same poor, that the one that has a higher level of tertiary schooling is the one that is going to catch up quicker to the technological frontier. Okay. Now you have extra effects also of secondary and tertiary schooling, and the typical pure productivity effects are coming from young age secondary schooled people, and that this is something also that we found in our in another setting in our science paper, our paper in science, is that the primary education of the older generation, so this mixture of primary education and experience, tends to be also a first factor affecting short-term affecting economic growth. So what we did is extremely simple. We took these numbers and we plugged in the data that you saw from Eric before. And we just needed to, on top of that, to bring some of the narratives of the shared socioeconomic pathways into the story. Because of course, those the human capital dynamics that were presented before and these parameters were not enough to reflect the whole qualitative narratives concerning things like between country convergence and stuff like that. So basically, well, you know that. Basically, we calibrated the model for each one of the SSPs using two different extra parameters. We still have a degree of freedom in the sense of that we can play around with the movements of the frontier, which are independent of human capital. The model is a panel data set, so we had country fixed effects and time fixed effects. The country fixed effects are unobservables in a country that affect economic growth and don't change over time. So we're going to think about that as institutions and culture or whatever. And we had the time fix effects that affect all countries in every period of time. We're going to think of that as shocks to the technological frontier that are independent of human capital. So with those guys, with the frontier growth, we can play. So we basically calibrated it to numbers that represented those qualitative narratives from the SSPs on the one hand. And then with the fixed effects that we obtained at the country level, we also could replicate part of the dynamics which were expected in terms of convergence or divergence or lack of convergence or divergence of institutional settings within countries that would create then this idea of having within, not only within country convergence to an equilibrium, but also between country convergence in equilibria. Okay? So we took all these things, plugged in the data, and this is what comes out. I don't know if you're familiar with BIM plots. This is a BIM plot. I discovered them a couple of months ago, and I'm completely in love with them. Not only me, but all my PhD students, because I don't know how to do them. So I give it to them, and they do them. This is a BIM plot. It's basically the empirical distribution of a variable, like you see in a normal empirical distribution, but it's divided into two subgroups. So what you're seeing here is the distribution of income per capita in the year 2010 for low-income countries. That's the dark one here. It's a mirror image of the distribution. And here you have the distribution of income per capita for middle and high-income countries. Okay? Here you have, it's the log of GDP per capita, so you have the poorer countries here, richer countries here. And depending on whether you're a middle or high-income country or a low-income country, you have you are on the upper distribution or in the lower distribution. The lines there are just the averages. Okay? So we start in 2010 with the same type of distribution for everybody, and what you see here is how those distributions look like in 2050 and in 2100 for each one of the SSPs over GDP per capita. Okay, so as you can see, they are basically representing exactly the type of story that you heard before from Erich. You have the middle of the road, so you do have, because you observe conditional convergence in the world in reality, so you're just projecting that further. You have extra increases in education that lead to more technology and more growth, so the whole world is becoming more equal in terms of between country income convergence and richer over time, right? In SSP1, of course, that is improved in the sense that you have richer countries on average as compared to SSP1 and more convergence. In SSP5, it's pretty much a very similar picture. And SSP3 and SSP4, as you can see, are completely different animals for different reasons, actually. So here you have the fragmented world. It's basically not letting any of those fixed effects that correspond to institutional quality, not letting them converge anywhere. So basically you are also projecting them to be constant over time. Then what happens is basically that you create a very spread distribution of income per capita. Poor countries remain poor in comparative terms, rich countries remain rich. And since everybody grows and poorer countries don't grow at higher rates than richer countries, then basically you end up with a very dispersed distribution of income per capita across countries. Here you have a pretty similar picture. However, it is caused by a polarization. So you do have some poor and middle-income countries that become richer, but some others get stuck in a poverty trap, and you create a kind of a bimodal distribution in here. Okay, so now we have this guy, we have all the other guys, we put them together into the Human Development Index, and you get pretty much a very similar picture to the one that I showed you with income per capita. So this is the Human Development Index for 2010, 2025, 2050, and 2075. I'm stopping in 2075 because since I need those expected years of schooling, and for the moment I only had them till 2100, Samir told me he has them already for a father, so now we can do this until 2100 as well. So we need to stop at 2075, at least for these projections. Okay? And as you can see, the picture, I'm not going to go very much into detail here, but the picture is pretty much the same as before. Please notice the Human Development Index, because of its relative nature, can only be compared within SSPs. It doesn't make any sense to compare numbers here with numbers here, because these guys refer to other maximum levels. That's a problem of the Human Development Index on its own, if you want to do different projections in different scenarios. Okay? Needless to say, the convergence patterns that you observe across the world are extremely different, which implies that depending on the type of world that you have in mind in terms of climate change and its effects, comparing today's Human Development Index or today's development measure of choice with whatever you think is going to happen may be a good idea, because there's no relationship between today's HDI and the future HDI, or it could be a horribly bad idea, because you would be basically underestimating, in many cases, the vulnerability, or under or overestimating the vulnerability that you're going to have. Okay, that was it. What I did is to provide an internally consistent framework based on human capital dynamics in order to obtain projections of the Human Development Index. The beauty of this is that it is all driven by changes in population, by age, sex, and education. Everything. There are assumptions, of course, on institutional quality, but they are relatively straightforward. The whole machinery here, the whole driving factor, is how people change. And it enters each one of the three components, and it makes sense in itself. It's a self-consistent type of setting. Okay, as you saw, we calibrated a set of Human Development Index projections corresponding to each one of the shared socioeconomic pathways. And in principle, the modeling framework is there. This is just one of the many things that you can do with it. So it's up to you to think of new ways in which you can assess the potential interaction between population, education, and income in the future. And if you want a consistent framework to think about it, here you have it already. Abrin, or you can work on this. Thank you.